there are efforts which are going on right now to improve the situation. But another issue which I think we started with is about the quality of the product. Okay, in terms of the quality of the product, as a consultant, I have seen a couple of projects. In fact, I have seen a project wherein three different types of modules connected to the same string inverter. I won't name the EPC player over here, but very well-known EPC player in the country. And three different sizes panels, 320 watt, 300 watt, and 340 watt panel connected to the same string inverter. Okay. So, and there are so many other issues. You know, people trying to cut corners on the structures. That's another big issue about the lightning arresters. So I would like to have a comment from the panelists about the quality of the systems and probably what needs to be done to improve or the quality or sustainability of these projects. Uday, would you like to go?
One of our service being a plant audit, unfortunately, we come across audits of even not only on the ground mount, but even on distributed projects. Scaling from 100 kilowatts to a megawatt before project handover or post-project handover. We've started seeing, or at least we've seen in few of our projects, few specific examples that an aluminium structures or MMS, what we call module mounting structures, have started sagging within 3 months period of time. And it just happens to make us realize that, and even the clamping, the way they have done, it is absolutely against what module manufacturers recommend. All module manufacturers have an installation guidelines where they say, for to support the frames, these are the areas where you should typically clamp. It's exactly the opposite, such that it leaves a stress, thereby leading a further some sort of a micro cracks inside the modules. And with the module micro cracks and all, this will lead to a degradation. All these impacts are very, very much there, and unfortunately, our industry, or at least the companies in Rooftop, we've, as even a player or as a member of this, the particularly solar domain, we've really not emphasized much the importance of engineering, the importance of procuring the good material. Even at within the company level, if Subhrangshu is a procurement manager, he has a lot more responsibility at his position to check the detailed bill of materials, do a factory audit, which I see typically happens on a megawatt project, but I've hardly heard any Rooftop or distribution company saying that we had gone to the factory to check the materials and everything. Another example was where we were acting as owner's engineer and we'd made a tender document to say that your generation guarantee would be based on PR and all that stuff. By the project, the person had not installed the weather station to measure the radiation. And my simple question to him was, how do you happen to measure the PR? And his response, sir, sab budget khatam ho gaya tha hamara. Whatever we had accounted for, we did not have it. So we made it make a loss. That was his response. And I could not respond to that question, like his statement. So you are giving a bank guarantee related to your PR and all. And glad the customer has hired an owner's engineer. In case if he had not done, what would you have done? Such shortcuts will not take the industry or to individual company to a long run. We've seen everywhere, see, companies focus majorly on modules. The effort of researching, speaking with all. I hardly see the same efforts being put in for a DC cable or for an cable, for nut bolts. Even if it's a walkway, what sort of a hot dip galvanized is it there? If it is by the coast, do they really recommend an FRP or an aluminium solutions? These kind of engineering thoughts has not been put in, which is little bit scary. And again, we keep giving presentations to make people understand that even though solar may not be your primary business, if it's your secondary or tertiary business, at the end, you're making a power plant. It needs serious thoughts and engineering efforts to do it without compromising on the quality.
Mr. Uday, I have seen companies who have done 70-80 megawatts in ground mounted utility projects. They have installed a lot many projects. It's basically, I'm talking about one particular company in our northern region. They have installed so many projects. अगर मॉड्यूल भी उधर से कोई चोरी करके लेके जाता है तो द ओनर ऑफ द कंपनी डजंट बॉदर, ठीक है कोई बात नहीं चलेगा, वो दूसरा मॉड्यूल लगा लेंगे एक्स्ट्रा में है. लेकिन रात को 3 बजे और उनके पास फ़ोन आता है, स्टॉर्म आ गया, ही सडनली वेक्स अप एंड रीचेस एट साइट एट 3 AM एट नाइट. क्योंकि जो स्ट्रक्चर उन्होंने लगाए हैं उनको पता है कि क्या लगाया है, और उसमें जो स्टॉर्म आ गया उसमें देखा गया, साइट पर जब पहुँचे तो सारे मॉड्यूल्स उड़ गए और स्ट्रक्चर सारे बेंड हो गए. तो जस्ट वही ऐड करना था टू उदय जी कि वी आर मोस्टली कंसंट्रेटिंग द प्राइस ऑफ मॉड्यूल अ बिट इन इन्वर्टर्स, बट मॉड्यूल प्राइसेस इफ यू कंसिडर टीयर वन मॉड्यूल्स ऑफ एनी चाइनीज और इंडियन टीयर वन मॉड्यूल्स, द प्राइसेस यू आर गेटिंग इज मोर लेस सेम प्राइसेस. आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट रूफटॉप प्रोजेक्ट्स, स्मॉल प्रोजेक्ट्स. आई मीन बट द BOS वी आर नॉट कंसेंट्रेटिंग ऑन BOS एक्चुअली. 10 rupee नट बोल्ट कैन कॉस्ट यू 1000 टाइम इफ इट इज नॉट अप द मार्क एंड अप टू द प्रॉपर क्वालिटी एंड सो. तो एक छोटा सा नट बोल्ट कैन कॉस्ट यू 1000 टाइम्स. एक स्टॉर्म आ गया तो वो रात को 3 बजे साइट पे क्यों पहुंच जाता है. तो दिस इज वन ऑफ द मेजर कंसर्न्स. एंड केबल्स ऑल्सो, इन्वर्टर्स ऑल्सो, वी नीड टू डिजाइन, आई मीन डिजाइन द इन्वर्टर, चूजिंग द प्रॉपर इन्वर्टर, कि कौन सा लोकेशन में प्रोजेक्ट लग रहा है. वी आर ओनली फोकसिंग ऑन द कॉस्ट, कौन सा इन्वर्टर चिप मिलेगा उसमें हम वी आवर नॉर्मल ट्रेंड टू गो विद दैट इन्वर्टर. बट डिपेंडिंग ऑन द लोकेशन, डिपेंडिंग ऑन द टिल्ट, अगर इन्वर्टर हम राइटली प्रॉपरली चूज करते हैं, इट लास्ट फॉर 25 years एंड गिव अस अ जनरेशन.
Yeah, I think we certainly there is an issue with the quality. But would one of you like to say something about how do you really ensure or what needs to be done to improve the quality? Okay, it's accepted that there is a challenge in terms of quality for the ground-mounted projects as well as for the rooftop projects. Rooftop projects is much more, and especially if the rooftop projects have come up in a capex mode, okay, it's even worse. Okay, so someone, the government of India has come out with the notification in terms of the quality standards very recently, I think around a month back. But still there are challenges, and I would like to hear your views in terms of what need to be done either by industry or by government or by SNAs in terms of ensuring quality.
Thank you. Good question there, and I mean probably I'm the least qualified to comment on these technical aspects. But I did come across an interesting survey in the past few weeks. One of the guys had come to our office from a leading global certification agency called Bureau Veritas. As a developer, more often than not, we will not have the bandwidth to really go to the module supplier's factory, or even the science for that matter, to pick out samples of the modules that are manufactured, ensure that the entire batch is as per the sample. I mean, we really don't have the technical or technical abilities or the time in terms of finishing that part off. But we can definitely outsource these sort of services to companies such as Bureau Veritas, who can actually go onto the factory for us and certify that the batch is as per their acceptable requirements. The requirements then can be, initially, before the survey, can be negotiated between us and Bureau Veritas. So like he mentioned, the different modules tend to be of different sizes, different makes. Some tend to have cracks, some may not be transportable, some might be transportable. These are the things that can be agreed upon with a reputed agency. And for a fraction of a cost, we can avoid a major loss that can happen repeatedly over the 15 to 20 years life of the project.
Yeah, there is a twin-pronged approach. One is with regards to the, when we talk about agencies which can help in monitoring the quality as such. Already Bureau of Indian Standards is looking at establishing quality regulations on the type of the material that comes in. For example, it could be modules, inverters, etc. That is one aspect of it. The second aspect is that MNRE has already come up with the guidelines on rooftop and distributed solar, which is fairly detailed. It's very detailed in the sense of it's already there on the uploaded on the website about 8-9 months back, which gives very clear guidelines as what kind of modules need to be used, what are the BOM in the modules, what needs to be there, what kind of inverters needs to be used, what should be the DC cables, what should be the kind of specifications of DC cables, what kind of structures needs to be used, what are the specifications. They've gone into various details. That is one part of it for anybody who is interested in looking at setting up, for example, in the commercial industrial space. This is a document which can be there. Second is that the most important aspect about ensuring the quality is that what is the, for an EPC company, for example, what is the kind of processes? Quality is basically an outcome of a process. So what is more important is what kind of processes a company has got to ensure that the quality is adhered to, right, in terms of its the kind of a design, the kind of material which they choose, what kind of vendor development processes do they have, how do they evaluate the vendors, how do they go and do the checks on the quality. These are the most basic things which are required to ensure that the quality of the installations is taken care of. Because today we are in an industry which has got the lowest entry barriers. Anybody can become an EPC. You work for about 4 years or 5 years in a company, in an EPC company, you go start off and you start your own. Ultimately, what differentiates between that small player and the big player who is there is the kind of fixed costs and the overheads which he's got. So customers need to understand this, because in a country like India where cost effectiveness or being value conscious, there's a difference being competitive, there's a difference being cheap, and the difference being value conscious. So you will find all this set of customers in the country. So what is important is for as an EPC player is that if you ask me from the side of Bosch, we choose our customers. We don't go after every single customer. We choose the kind of customers whom we want to go, who understand the quality. We explain to them to the processes, but we still come across a lot of companies which are out there, which are funded very well with low cost funds, which can come out with any kind of system. Even though we tell the companies, hey, why don't you come and look at our installations, we educate them saying that please go and have a look at one of the installations, what has been done, compare, and then you go out and make your this thing. We explain to them, but still at the end of the day, cost considerations are the play a primary role. And ultimately there are, we win some, we lose some, but we are very happy with the kind of companies which we choose, which understand the quality. And we have to explain it, it's a really a hard, what can I say, hard sell which we need to make. But at the end of the day, I will say that such of those companies which sign on to us, there are quite a few, but it's quite a challenging one, I must say. And yep. Another thing is, most important is that as an EPC company, you also have to be profitable. We are out there to make money. And the rooftop segment has become so competitive that gone are the days where we can talk about double-digit margins. We are now talking about anything on single-digit margins, and sometimes it goes up closer to 5%. If you are under a lot of pressure, you end up getting into such kind of a scenarios. So it's not a very good thing, especially for an industry which is just in its, I wouldn't say a nascent stage, in a self-replicating phase, where it's really poised to really go off in a very big way. So it is very, very important that we need to educate the customers on quality, and it's a very, very tough call, I must say that.
Niranjan very rightly pointed out, I think the quality is on two levels. Number one, all of the panelists have mentioned about the bill of material or the panels, inverters, cables, BOAs, etc. Definitely that contributes to the major portion of the quality of the system. I find lot of ignorance when it comes to quality of panels in the sector. The reason being, whenever we are in front of customers, there are three players, let us say. Me and Niranjan are quoting same panels to the project because customer wants a particular panel. So our data sheets are identical. Our warranty certificates are going to be identical. And then customer is at a loss to really figure out that some of our numbers are different. Either the price, the generation guarantee, or other numbers. How does a customer really differentiate between one EPC and another EPC? So that's one quality parameter. There is no benchmark today in the industry which customer can make this decision based on this is a better quality EPC or this is a better quality developer. Honestly speaking, industry hasn't come up with any ideas, and I think there has been some discussion going on how this benchmarking can be done. Second, all of us know that majority portion of the cost and the performance of the project, solar power project, goes into the panels. When I'm talking to customers, customers ask us what is the efficiency of the panel, and they think that they have done thorough analysis of how do they ensure that they get good quality panels. And if I say this particular panel 16.7% efficiency, someone else has given them 17.2% efficiency, and they say your panels are less efficient or this is not a good quality panel, right? People are smiling. I tell them, all of us probably in this room own a car or a two-wheeler. Which is the question that bogs our mind when we are buying a car or two-wheeler? Yes. How many of us know what is the efficiency of engine of our car or two-wheeler? Nobody knows. It is reflected into our benefit in terms of kitna deti hai. Same is true with solar panels. It's not about that efficiency, but how much is the savings and how much is the generation linked to that. So, lot of ignorance out there. And second part to that, what needs to be tested? So yes, I take your point that we should appoint or outsource inspection to these agencies. But I'll share an interesting anecdote. So these agencies have very strong team of inspectors. And inspectors in the sense, good quality inspectors. The trouble is, the leading expert solar specialists don't join those companies. Okay.
Yeah.
So they have, I mean, pardon me for making a bold statement, they have limited knowledge about what to test in the panel. They go as per a standard quality assurance plan and they go and check it. The EL test or micro crack someone mentioned, when I went first time, I couldn't make out which is a micro crack and which is a grain in the panel. So that level is a problem. So that knowledge needs to come first in EPCs so that we are able to inspect it in the right way, or we are able to command that these are the tests, these are the results we should have. So on both counts, quality of EPC and the quality of plant that goes into it, these are the two important aspects, I believe.
Yep. Thank you very much for those elaborate answers. Before throwing it open for all of you to ask questions, my last question specifically to Jankrut. We need to expand the market. Okay, currently we are concentrating on C&I segment and with a very specific set of clients. And I think every EPC player or a boot player in this room is kind of targeting those markets. How do we really expand the market? And you know, if you have to expand, certainly you need to go to the residential category, some other categories of the consumers. We need to have a different boot models to be implemented. So where does he see in terms of this development, especially with the strong counterparty credit requirements of the banks?
Thank you. That's a tough question, part of the business strategy, I would say. Sure. So in terms of expanding the market, and I will definitely be talking solely from my own standpoint on credit risk. I do a lot of analysis and research on the credit aspect, on the default ratings of a lot of counterparties. So, a business guy would come to me and probably tell me that, first identify the set of industries who have a lot of power requirements. Second step, he will identify BBB-, BBB+ or above rated clients. And then, he would probably give that list to me to sort of do an analysis on the locations. I think right now, with a lot of companies being identified as the part of the new bankruptcy code, that's a new niche of customers that we have, we can rather chase. The biggest opportunity, in my opinion, is the steel sector, for example. I mean, we have seen the likes of, Uttam Galva, SR Steel, that have defaulted, and I'm sure the smaller players that are a part of this supply chain are not doing well. But all of these clients are finding alternate buyers. The industry's who's who want to buy these clients. So a defaulted company like SR has New Metal, or even ArcelorMittal, who has bid for these companies. If you look at these defaulted clients, they would have been ignored for the past 3 to 5 years, where we have seen the good boom in rooftop solar. And then engaging with them at this point of time, where probably, you know, they would not be in a great position to negotiate the tariffs, and we are in a good position to build a good system for them that will give them value as well as a good cost, would definitely be a great place to be in. Further to that, an administrator who's looking after each invoice that the company is repaying would be more than happy to entertain a company, a developer, especially because for an SR to run, he might be paying, you know, 8 rupees, 9 rupees or 10 rupees for each unit. And then you come in saying, I'll provide 10% of the power for 6 rupees or 5 rupees. That just increases, you know, his bargaining power in terms of, you know, the pricing for the company itself that needs to be sold. So probably, yes, I think, you know, like now re-scraping the entire database of existing CNI customers will give out opportunities of high off-taker, of you know, large off-takers with currently poor credit quality, but showing tremendous potential over the next 6 to 12 months.
Okay, thank you. Now, you know, I would request you to ask question again. My specific request, please identify yourself, your affiliation, and be specific in question and to whom you are asking. Thank you.
Can someone hand over mic here?
Hello, I'm Sanjeev Rao. I'm an IB consultant, and I work in various fields other than energy also. My address, I wouldn't say it's a question, but an address to both Suhas as well as Niranjan. You, both of you, are talking about quality and durability and price. But the problem is that you are approaching the rooftop industry as an infrastructure company rather than a consumer durable or a white goods company. I am a secretary of a society. You come and tell me your system is going to be there for 25 years. Am I going to remain the secretary for the 25 years? Or all the members of the society which are there today going to remain for 25 years? Give them a 5-year solution at a lower cost. All of them will be happy. I think you also need to change your mindset that you are no longer an infrastructure company when you go to individual societies and residentials and smaller factories, but you should go to them. iPhone sells at 65,000 rupees, and LG sells at 10,000 rupees. Both the smartphones give the same utility, and iPhone is discarded in 3 years, LG phone is discarded in 2 years. So I would say, please revisit your business, strategy, and come out with a strategy where there is a 4 or 5 year solution with a good ROI for the societies, and you will make good progress in this industry. I think please come out of the infrastructure mind, because it's nobody knows what's going to happen in the next 25 years. That's what it is.
I agree. I think there are some players who are looking at it as a white good industry and trying to develop the solution, but those solutions are typically very small. Okay, if you have to install 15-20 kilowatt peak, or that is the smallest I would say, but typical society would have 35-50 kilowatt. 5 years payback period, I don't know. Suhas, would you like to comment?
So really appreciate your thoughts, and I was not sure whether you are complimenting us or contradicting us.
Sorry, I'm not complimenting, neither am I saying something wrong about you. Yeah. What I'm saying is that you need to revisit your business strategy and the way you approach the market.
Yeah.
Because again, today, even if you buy furniture, you buy something from, say, Pepperfry or somebody, or from home, living home, or you buy it from the local carpenter, you're going to anyway throw it after 5 years. You're not going to keep it after for longer than 5 years. Why pay 5 lakh rupees to a branded company? That is the normal mindset. If you're an Amitabh Bachchan, you will say that, yes, I need a 5 lakh rupee sofa to show it to my this thing, that yes, I can afford a 5 lakh rupee sofa. It's the same thing with cooperative societies and everything. दुनिया को दिखाना है, दुनिया को दिखाना है, that's all.
मैं request, you know, please have a conversation between the panelist and you.
Yeah. I 100% agree with you. As a salesperson, or head of sales, I always tell over my sales team that do not try to sell what we have. Try to sell what customer really needs and not wants again. Yeah.
Okay.
Number one, we have done close to 27 installations in the residential societies. Okay, more than 500 kilowatt together, totally. So the point I'm making is there is a success story on residential as well, CHS. And what is it? You are perfectly on dot. For residential societies, and I'm talking primarily of the common areas, not individual houses, the payback is less than 4 years, and in many cases it is 2.5 years. So honestly speaking, anyone can install that system, and as you rightly said, after 3 years, if you think you have got your money back, you can really throw off the system and go for a new technology if there is after 5 years, number one. The second example is 25 years of life. We are saying that it will help you and get so much savings in 25 years. Proof of pudding very close to that. Our another brother is in water heating, solar water heating. And those who have installed it have been reaping benefits more than 10 years. So I am 100% with you. We are actually, we meaning all the solar industry when it comes to residential, are following what you are recommending. So we are saying that the payback in your case is something like 3 to 4 years. And there is a proof of pudding that the system will still last 25 years, if not at least 10 years. So I think that is well taken care.
Whosoever is giving you quality, when you talk about efficiency, more number of customers, more efficiency. PVC is simulations, but this may not be all of people for customer or past not to the customer change. So it depends upon the consideration that you are giving for giving the best of the system to the customer.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. Let him say then. Yeah.
I'm Sachin Agrawal. I'm representing Godrej. My question to Balwant, you and probably Uday. In solar sector especially, now we are talking about the L1, that is the price. Anyway, we had a long discussion on this one. But why not, as a consultant, you change your mindset from L1 to V1, that is the value one. Because being as a consultant, you can educate your developer or the owner in a way that you go for the specific product quality. And then you evaluate the EPC players or anyone on the value that what they are bringing to the table, rather than only talking about the price, because quality will come at a price. So what is how you go about your customer?
Thanks, Sachin. Absolutely, yes, I agree. It lies, the onus of educating a customer lies with us, definitely. And typically, when we get quotations, I've made it a point to talk to all customers, and in my present projects as well, in the past as well, is I think we've never gone with the L1. We've never gone with the L1 EPC company. There are processes, like let's say when I make a tender, so it's not based on the pricing of an N1, as the gentleman said, that go with the best in the world. You give a customer the option of Canadian Jinko or something, and they're backing up reasoning that these are top 5 rated companies. Go for inverters, go for SMA Germany or something like that. And you educate the customer that your option A, option B and option C. Which one would you like to go? The pros and cons of each. Based on, say, he says, fair enough, I think I would be, I'm happy with option B. So, 25 saal nahi, 10 saal chalega, but I know what is it, this is where it is. Fair enough. Then you go for those quotations. And when we even get those quotes and we do it, we actually make a site visit with the customer, and among, let's say, 10 companies are bidding for it. We take the 3 companies who are going to be shortlisted. We actually take a visit to those sites along with the customer and show them. It is only not about the product that you're procuring. It is the workmanship. It is about the protection system in place. Those are the criterias, definitely I see it. And as I said, at least in my last 5 projects that I know, none of the L1 customers have really got the order.
And from the customer side, I can say one thing is that Every time we have been there, we have never been L1. We have always been L3, L4. But despite that, we have always got the project and come out, primarily because the customer was very conscious about the quality. Like what he just said is that when we insisted the customer to have a look at our installations of all the, you know, all the competitors who are there, and then we invariably see that we give a set of specifications to the customer, make them understand what these specifications are, and ask them to evaluate all the competitors based on these specifications. And then you will actually, and once you do the installations, once they go and do the inspection on the installations being done, then it becomes easier for the customer to make his choice. And invariably, the customer, if he understands the quality, he will make the right choice.
Okay, let me try and answer from as a consultant to the procurer point of view. See, typically the when the bid is floated, you don't know how many parties are going to bid. We assist the several procurers in procuring the solar power or RE power, to be frank enough. Not only solar, we also help them in some other RE power. So once the price bids are received, only you look at first of all L1 to L5. L6, L7, L1, L8 are usually you don't look at it. And for the private sector clients, there would be typically 5-6 parties. If it is then the shortlisted parties, that's a different story. But as soon as you visit the site, as soon as you start insisting, saying that this is what we are expecting in terms of quality, and when you ask for a revised quote, this is a very standard practice in the private sector at least. Okay, the L1, L2, L3 would drop out. That's our usual experience. Then what would remain is the one or two quality players at little lower than what they had originally quoted, and then you enter into contract with them. So if you finally ask, at the end of the day, he's L1. Because even in the private sector, this is a challenge that you can't enter into a contract. Their internal audit committees and other committees would get on you, okay, if you enter into a contract with L4. But in the process, the way you run the process, you ensure that the non-quality players drop out. And that's how you get ensure that the quality players remain there.